sun. I believe in the risen one.
Well, good morning, friends. Welcome to our 11:15 service here at Grace Church. I apologize. I think we may be a moment or so late. We had some technical difficulties with Wi-Fi, so I think we got those resolved. So hopefully you can see me and hear me in real time. I want to welcome you this morning to our virtual space. This is our second service that we've done, that I've done here in this space this morning. I'm here alone in the church. It's very quiet. I am, as I joked in the first service, I am the sound guy. I am the pastor, and I may, you know, maybe I'll be the custodian before we're done here. I apologize for that glare. I wanted to get the back wall of the cross, and so maybe next week we'll try moving up into the platform. Again, this is all a work in process and progress, so I want to thank you for your patience and your love and care with us as we try to bring these virtual services to you on Facebook Live. So want to welcome you. I am going to be able to set up the slides so that you can see those and move along through the service with us. Again, unfortunately this week we will not have any musicianship with us, but it's my hope that in the weeks to come we're able to splice together a little more robust service using things like Zoom, like we're using this morning, to bring in some musicians from the comfort of their own home and the safety of their own home, so that we can be together and worship with music, song, prayers, a sermon, all those kinds of things. So welcome. I hope you're doing okay. I know this is a very strange time in the life of the world. And I know that all of us are experiencing reality in a very different way right now. We're staying home. Our work lives are affected. Our family lives are affected. The lives of our students are affected as they're at home. And so there's a lot to juggle. I just want to acknowledge that and name that for you and for me as we come to this time of worship. So I want to welcome you and ask you that for the next several minutes, let's try to just disengage with the reality of what we're dealing with right now and just engage with God and to trust God over these next several minutes together, that that God can indeed does and is holding the world together. So I'm so glad that you're here. I'm glad that you found us. And it's my hope and prayer that I'll offer you something this morning that'll give you a word of hope and encouragement that you can take into your week as you creatively, just like me, creatively try to find ways to share and show the love of Jesus in our city. So just a couple announcements as we begin worship this morning. Most of you know who I am. But for those of you who don't, my name is Eric Keeve. I have the privilege of being the lead pastor here at Grace, and I am delighted to be the lead pastor. It's an honor and privilege. This is a great church. If you don't have a church home and you live here in Bay City or even in the Tri-Cities area in the Bay region, we'd love for you to make Grace Church your home. We'd love to have you here, not only in this virtual space, but when we get back to meeting together in physical proximity, we would love to have you with us here at Grace. So welcome this morning. Just a couple things I want to move us through announcement-wise. I want to remind you that Facebook, in addition to our website, but Facebook is really the place where you can get updates in real time about what's going on in the church. It's much easier for us to do so through Facebook. So we have two Facebook pages because we have two campuses. Grace Church Bay City is for our West Campus and Grace Church East Campus is for our East Campus. Both are active and vibrant campuses of Grace Church here in the city. So make sure you check both of those pages regularly. Services, we're doing our best to bring you both services to both of our pages. So Pastor Jeff led a 9:30 service from his home this morning on the East Campus page. I led one at 9:30 on our Grace Church Bay City page from here. I live not too far from our West Campus, and I felt it might be good for us to see a familiar backdrop, even though we can't be here at the church. Plus, my wife's just began a 10-day stint at St. Mary's Hospital in Saginaw working. She's a physician's assistant, and so my kids may be running around at home and it's just easier to do this unencumbered, I think, in this space. So we're going to do our best to bring you more and more robust services each week. We may even do some creative collaboration, but check out these pages. Also, Sarah Lynn and I, our small groups person, we're hosting a small group session every Wednesday, 2 o'clock here on the Grace Church Bay City page. So if you're one of our small groups that we're moving through this Lent, you can watch us and comment in real time on the Facebook page as we're moving through that. I want to invite you, if you have not already, to really join our email distribution list. We have a weekly e-newsletter that goes out here, goes out every Friday. We call it Grace Notes. And it's got articles, announcements, some thoughts usually from myself and other staff people. It's a really helpful tool for us to communicate quickly and effectively with all of you. All it takes for you is to go to our website, and there's a spot where you can click on to join the mailing list. And it'll be in your inbox every Friday morning to the email of your choice. If you want to go back through the archives, you can see on the screen there, you can simply go to baycitygracechurch.org/more/gracenotes. And there lists the full archive of our Grace Notes that you can get back issues and the like. So again, if you haven't joined that list, I can't encourage you enough to do so. And we do mail them out. So if you do need some mail to you, if you prefer snail mail and email is not your first communication of choice, or if you're unable to get on email, just let us know at the church and we'll do our best to get those mailed to you. Just a reminder, the church, there is someone in the church office from 9 to noon. We are not open, quote unquote, for regular business. One of the reasons we are staffing a person here is because I found out this week that we are the only church on the west side of the Saginaw River that is maintaining their food pantry. So we're part of the Bay County Emergency Food Pantry Distribution System. So we want to make sure that in this time of food scarcity and financial scarcity that families can get food. So we're committed to doing so. And we're doing that in very safe ways. So we're doing that in a way that has absolutely no contact between the person receiving the food and our staff person handing out the food. So again, you can call the church office usually between 9 and noon, Monday through Thursday, as we've adjusted our office hours, and someone will be here during that time to answer your call. If not, we've sent out one call, automated call to our church. I've put it in our latest edition of Grace Notes. If you need myself or Pastor Jeff, our cell phones are in there. Please don't hesitate to call. We would love to be helpful in any way that we can. So as we come to worship this morning, let's just start with just a prayer, right? Let's just pause. And I don't know about you, but I've been carrying a lot of the stress. I usually carry it in my neck and shoulders, and that's where I felt it this last several weeks. And so my body is, I imagine your body begins to experience sort of the physical effects of the emotional strain that we're under. And a lot of us are wondering about, you know, friends we know and love who are dealing with financial issues because maybe their jobs have been furloughed or they've been laid off or their hours have been drastically cut. People are wondering how they can pay bills and get food. Some of us know people who are struggling with COVID-19 and who have been diagnosed with that. So there's just a lot that we're bringing into this virtual space this morning. So let's just take a minute or two to sort of just let that fall at the feet of Christ and trust that as we're together in worship this morning, that Christ is big enough to handle that. So let's bow in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, I'm alone in this space this morning, but joined by so many in our virtual space. It's amazing how I can hear the building here at our West Campus breathe. That as the wind moves around outside, I can hear tiles on the roof shift. I can hear the branches blow. I can feel the building sort of inhale and exhale. Lord, as we come this morning, so many of us have probably spent more time in our homes in the last 2 weeks than we've spent maybe in our homes in the last 2 months or 2 years. And we recognize that this is just a hard season, that social distancing is difficult. And we have tools at our disposal, Lord, and we recognize that we can come together in virtual spaces, but it's just not the same. So as we come this morning, Lord, we come hopeful and expectant that even in this virtual space, you're going to meet us here, that you're going to offer us words of hope, that we're going to find you in these moments wherever we are, whether we're in Bay City, Midland, Saginaw, or even across the world or across the country. That your spirit connects us, not simply virtually, but in reality. That if we are brothers and sisters in Christ, then we are connected, not only to you, but to one another. So Holy Spirit, inhabit these places in which we find ourselves this morning, and just be real to us in ways that are undeniable and concrete. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And as I like to do here at Grace, when the gathered community is here, we say all together, amen. Well, I want to read a scripture this morning. I'm going to read a couple, but this is where we're going to sort of launch from. This is from the book of James, the fifth chapter. This is an important verse. And so let's just read. It's just one verse. Therefore, confess your sins to each other, James writes, and pray for each other so that you may be healed. And here's why. James writes, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't feel very righteous, right? But when we are in Christ, we have a righteousness that is not our own. That's what the scriptures tell us. And so that when you and I pray for one another, it's actually quite effective. More effective than maybe even we would suspect. So this morning, I want to welcome you to part five of our series, How to Pray. And you can see right on the screen there, we're moving through this book as a church this Lent season called How to Pray, A Simple Guide for Normal People. And I love this book. I bought it last year simply because of the title, because most of the books on prayer that I've read are really lofty and they have these really complex and sort of holy sounding words. But this is just a book for normal people. And I don't know about you, but most of my life, I feel pretty normal. I mean, I do not feel like a spiritual superhero most of the time. In fact, I don't think I've ever felt like a spiritual superhero. So we're reading this great book. You can get it on Amazon. It's on Kindle. You can order a copy. I think we have a few copies left here at the church. We have a little over 140 people in our small groups right now going through this book. And so it's been really, really good. If you were with us last week in this virtual space, you'll remember that we had sort of a more robust service, right? We had our musicians were here and we were able to live stream the whole service. However, this past Monday, Michigan's governor, Gretchen Whitmer, I think wisely issued a shelter at home executive order, which meant that really all non-essential personnel are not allowed to report to work in many circumstances. And I think that's good because we need to, as difficult as it is, separate ourselves from each other so we're not spreading COVID-19. But again, let me just encourage you, if you haven't already, make use of those digital and virtual spaces. I'll say a little bit more about that later. So as a church, we're committed to keeping our members safe, and that includes our volunteers, that includes our staff people. And so again, I hope that in the coming weeks, as our learning curve as a staff begins to ramp up, I guess is what I would say, we'll be able to offer a little bit more robust worship service. We'll be able to offer some music and splice in some things. We'll invite some musicians and leaders to participate from the comfort of and safety of their own homes. So we're working really hard to try to make that happen. As I mentioned last week, who knew, right, that this series that we're in right now would be as timely as it's been? You know, we planned this series last year. We planned our message, our teaching team plans a year in advance And so we planned the series last fall specifically, and it seemed to me that almost in an uncanny fashion, at least for the last several weeks, the topics that we've needed to cover are things that we've needed to hear. They're things that we've also needed to put in practice personally and as a community here at Grace. Last week, we had a conversation about the art and the practice of lament, right? Of biblical lament. And I don't know about you, but I needed that message. I needed not only to hear that message, I needed to practice what I preached. And so I've been doing so this week. I know that this pandemic of COVID-19 has worn heavy upon each of us with every single passing day. And so to keep our sanity, it seems to me that we need, friends, we need to be able to lament, don't we? But we learn that lament is not just about complaining about the state of things, right? It's not just griping and moaning about how things are. A biblical lament is much deeper, and it's much richer, and it's much more textured than that. We remember these words from King Solomon, again, popularized in, I don't know if that's the right way to say it, in the 60s, early 70s by, was it the Mamas and the Papas? I can't remember. But there's a time for everything, right? And a season for every activity under the heavens. There is a time to weep and there is a time to mourn. And we don't like that reality, but just as there's a time to celebrate things, there's a time to feel it, right? Deep in our heart, deep in our bones. And that seems to be the season that we're in right now. Last week, we talked about how from a biblical perspective, lament is rooted in the notion that when things are hard, when life is difficult, because life can be difficult, even under the best of circumstances, we're invited to fully name and claim the pain that we're feeling and then release it back to the one whose heart breaks with and for us. And that one is God himself. And again, we talked about how biblical lament isn't just about moaning, right, and griping. Biblical lament is about crisis communications correctly oriented, right? The person, the subject of whom we're speaking to, is the right person. When we rightly practice lament, we're committed, in spite of everything we're going through, to hold on to hope, even in the midst of what may feel like a helpless situation. And we learned last week that the art and the practice of biblical lament, it teaches us that even when we feel helpless, that we are never, ever hopeless. That even when we feel helpless as people, we are never, ever hopeless. And let me just say here that if you've missed any of our previous messages in this series, now would be a great time to make use of your stay-at-home experience to catch up on the conversation that we've been having. You can check out the messages on our website under the More tab and then click on Teachings. I'll try to put that link in the comments when we're finished here. I think they'd be really helpful. They've been really, frankly, as your pastor, they've been really helpful for me to not only read these chapters, but also to work through the putting together these messages, because it's been really ministering to my own soul. I've needed to hear what we're talking about. And so this week, we're going to turn our attention to the practice of confession in prayer. And again, confession really isn't a sexy word. It's not a word that we welcome. But if you're part of the Grace Church community, or part of the church community at all, you know that a lot of times we regularly pray the Lord's Prayer. In our second service, we don't do it every Sunday because we want to keep it fresh, but we do pray it quite often. And every time I pray that prayer, every single time, there is this word in the prayer that really makes my heart stop for just a minute. It really causes me to pause. And it's not a big word. It's not one of those biblical words. It's a very simple word. And it's the word as, A-S, right? You know this prayer, right? But you know this phrase, forgive us our trespasses or sins, as some traditions pray it. Forgive us our trespasses or sins as, there's the word, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And every time I pray this prayer, every single week, I can't but stop and think, what if my capacity to be forgiven is somehow mysteriously linked to my ability to forgive others? Think about that for a minute. What if my capacity, maybe not to be forgiven, but what if my capacity to experience forgiveness? Maybe that's a better way of saying it, is somehow mysteriously linked to my ability to forgive others. Wow, I mean, that just gets me every time. And the way that we primarily experience and practice forgiveness between God and ourselves and between ourselves and others is through this practice of confession. And here's why. You know this and I know this. Guilt is corrosive, right? When we carry guilt, it's just corrosive. Nothing good comes of it. And guilt isn't born out of the wrong or the sin itself. Rather, it comes from a deep and abiding awareness that we have wronged God or we have wronged someone else. And the longer that we deny the wrong, the greater the weight of the burden becomes. I've experienced this in my life, and I know you have too. And so confession is the means by and through which we participate in what I would call a relational maintenance between ourselves and God and ourselves and others. Because here's the thing that you know and I know. Guilt is a cosmic separator and alienator. It sucks the life out of our relationships with God, and it sucks the life out of our relationships with others. This is what Peter Grieg writes in his book. He says this. He says, friends, we cannot detach our relationships with people from our relationship with God. In other words, we cannot be more reconciled with God than we are with our neighbor. So what he means by this, we can't be just right with God and at odds with everyone else. We have to be right with God and right with each other. If you look at the Ten Commandments or you look at the Lord's Prayer, there's both a cosmic dimension and what I would call a creaturely dimension. Things that have to do with myself and God, things that have to do with myself and others. And I think the same goes for confession. And it seems to me that confession is the only means of developing a lasting relational wholeness and holiness. And I want you to be clear that confession does not activate the grace of God. God's grace is given to us freely. Rather, it responds to grace. It responds to the grace that's already been offered. And only then can we really experience that forgiveness for ourselves. I love this quote from Frederick Buechner from the book, How to Pray. Peter Grieg quotes him. Buechner says this, to confess your sins to God is not to tell God anything he doesn't already know. Isn't that great? Like, we're not telling God things that he does not already know about us. But he goes on to say, but until we confess them, however, they are the abyss between God and ourselves. When you confess them, Buechner writes, they become the Golden Gate Bridge. Isn't that a great image? Right? You know, maybe freshman Michiganders, it's not the Golden Gate Bridge. Maybe they become the mighty Mackinac Bridge. Peter Grieg comments on it this way. He says, our greatest need and God's greatest gift are the same thing, forgiveness of sins. And to receive it, to receive the forgiveness of sins, we only have to ask it and ask for it. And then we have to pass it on to others, right? There's that Lord's Prayer thing, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those. So we receive it from God, then we pass it on to others. But to ask for it, Grieg says, we must first admit that we need it. You know, it's been said, this is the saying you've probably heard, it's probably as old as time, that confession is what? Good for the soul, right? Confession is good for the soul. What I want us to understand this morning, though, is confession isn't just good for the soul, but confession can make you whole. It's not just good for the soul, but it can make us whole as people. So this morning, we're going to head back to the book of the Psalms. We've sort of been camped out in the book of the Psalms through this series so far. And the psalm we're going to read this morning was written by someone who not only knew the deep, dark, and distressing powers of sin and guilt, but also someone who understood God's readiness and God's willingness to forgive and to set free. And that guy is King David. And before I give you some background on his life and the context out of which his psalm was probably written, let's just hear from David himself. This comes from Psalm 32. We're going to read the whole thing. It's just 11 verses. David writes this: "Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is found no deceit. When I kept silent," David writes, "my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me, and my strength was zapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover up my iniquity. And I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Because you do that, God," David writes, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye upon you. Don't be," David writes, "don't be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad," David writes, "you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart." Let's pause here for a minute and let's pray. God, as we come to the pages of the sacred text this morning, I pray that you would meet us here in this place and in this space, and that you would do that work in us that only you can do, that transformative work that builds us and shapes us and molds us into the people who would bear a better likeness of your son, Jesus. We thank you for this time and ask you to plant something deep in us that's good, not just for us, but also for those whom you bring into our lives each and every day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And again, as we say here at Grace, all God's people said, amen. Now, some things about David. David was the second of three kings under a united Israel. After David's reign ended, the monarchy passed on to his son Solomon. But shortly after Solomon's reign ended, the kingdom of Israel split into two kingdoms, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. Psalm 32 that David wrote here is one of seven what are called penitential psalms in the Psalter. Simply, they're psalms of confession and reconciliation, in which the writer embraces and confesses their own brokenness. They offer it to God through the practice of confession, and then they're restored to a right and life-giving relationship with God. And then they go around and they teach others what they've learned from their own experience. And this is exactly what we see at play here in this psalm from David. Now, without going into great detail, because if you've lived within the orbit of the church for any part of your life, you know this story pretty well. If you want to refresh your memory of the story, you can look at the Old Testament book of 2 Samuel, chapter 11 and 12, and that'll give you the full backstory for this psalm. And it's quite a read. So it's two chapters. Let me encourage you to do that this week. But to keep it brief, David has had a hard time keeping his libido in check, and he finds himself in a precarious situation with another man's wife who he pursued. He pursued this woman while his army was off to war, which the writer tells us in 2 Samuel is where David should be with his men. David is at home, exactly where he shouldn't be. And as a result, he comes across the pretty woman next door. And so he engages in this extramarital affair, really. And after finding out that this woman is pregnant now with his child, he comes up with a scheme to have her husband come in from the front lines and, have relations with her. And it turns out that her husband, a guy named Uriah, is more honorable even than David, and he can't think of sleeping with his wife while his men are out in the field in harm's way, sleeping under the stars. And so that doesn't work. And then David says, "Well, I'm going to have Uriah killed," and that's exactly what he does. So after all this, David's chief advisor is a guy named Nathan. He calls David on his stuff, and you should read it because it's really good. It's really riveting, and it's brilliant how he traps David. And David realizes that he's caught. He's gripped immediately by the depth of the depravity that he's done. And immediately David reaches out to God. And not only does David ask God for forgiveness, he also expresses a willingness to embrace the consequences that are going to come as a result of his actions. I mean, this is what I love about David. He doesn't try to dress it up. He doesn't try to blame anyone else. He doesn't try to blame the devil. He doesn't try to blame this woman. He doesn't try to blame his circumstances. He doesn't try to blame anyone else. He offers no excuses. He just owns his junk, and he knows that it's his. And I think this is precisely why David is known throughout the scriptures as a guy man after God's own heart. I mean, David has done some pretty dark stuff. Wouldn't you agree? But he's called within the pages of the scriptures a man after God's own heart. And here's why. He knew how to confess, and he knew how to live in and experience forgiveness. So I want to take a few moments to look at this psalm. And as I see it, there are essentially four movements that we sort of move through in these 11 verses. First, in verses 1 and 2, there's this idea of blessedness that's associated with forgiveness, or a blessedness that comes from forgiveness. In the next 2 verses, 3 and 4, David shares with us what the burden of unconfessed guilt can do to you. It just weighs heavy upon you. It just eats at you. After that, in verses 5 through 7, David speaks of the relief of confession, like what his body, what his whole psyche, what his soul has gone through after he's just cleansed himself and given this over to God. And then finally, in verses 8 through 11, David speaks from the wisdom of his own experience, of what it's taught him and how he hopes to teach others from it. And so as we move through towards wrapping this up this morning, I want to take a moment just to look at each one of these and really briefly unpack them, because they're important. First, there's this idea that the blessedness that's associated with forgiveness. David starts out the whole psalm, right? Blessed, blessed. And again, if you're a follower of Christ, if you've been a part of the church, you begin to ask yourself, where have I heard words like that before? And then we just reflect and we think, oh yeah, Jesus says that, right? That's how Jesus begins the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. He issues these things we call Beatitudes. Blessed, Jesus says. And this is essentially the same thing that David is doing here. This Hebrew word that David uses, it carries with it the idea of a freedom and a happiness that comes from a lightness of heart. So this blessedness is a freedom and a happiness that comes from a lightness of heart. David explains to us that the one who's embraced this practice of confession receives no less than 3 different things from God in the process. First, he experiences, or she experiences, a carrying away of one's sins, and then a covering over of those sins, and then a cancellation of the ultimate weight of the debt of those sins. So there's a carrying away, there's a covering over, and there's a cancellation of the ultimate weight of the debt. In other words, they're not counted against David, and our sins aren't counted against us when we bring them to the Lord and offer them to him. These are metaphoric and poetic images that are derived from the original Hebrew language of the text. Simply put, the weight is lifted. Next, you know, we've all known the burden of guilt, yeah? Right? That exhaustion that comes from carrying the secret baggage that we've yet to unload. And David, like us, seems to understand that it wasn't just an emotional issue or a mental issue. It was a spiritual issue as well, yeah? I mean, when we carry around guilt, it can take a physical toll on our bodies as well, can't it? Friends, here's the thing that we already know, and I know you know this, and I already know this, but here it is again. Silence is a form of denial that separates us from God and separates us from one another. And as David correctly diagnoses, denial leads to spiritual, emotional, and mental, and in some cases, even physical rot. The imagery that he uses here in the Hebrew language of the text is the language of atrophy, of simply wearing out, of undergoing decay and decomposition. You see, denial is unhealthy, and it's almost impossible to maintain. You know, the scriptures are clear that we're called to not only confess our sins to God, but to share them with one another, to confess them with one another, ask people to pray for us in those difficult moments, in those difficult seasons where we're wrestling with difficult things. We were born to bear the burdens of one another. This is what Paul gets at in Galatians 6, 1 through 2, when he says this, "Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should tell them they should have known better." No. Paul writes, those of you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. Not judge them, not heap guilt upon them, not tell them how royally they've screwed up, but to restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted. And many think what Paul is talking about here is not tempted with a certain sin, but tempted to think that you're better than the person who's dealing with whatever sin they're dealing with. But watch yourselves, Paul says, or you may also be tempted. And then he says, carry each other's burdens. And in this way, Paul writes, you'll fulfill the law of Christ. So we're called to bear one another's burdens so that we don't have to carry this on our own. So next, and this is really where David hits his high note. David shares in verses 5-7 about the power and the freedom that comes from after we've owned our sin, confessed it to God, gotten it off our chest, and experienced the forgiveness and the freedom that God has secured for us in Christ. And David teaches us that confession really is made up of about three movements. First, we acknowledge to God something that we know already exists, something that God knows already exists, but we need to be able to name it and to offer it to God, right? We're broken and we're in need of grace. Next comes the confession proper, where we name what ails us, and then we claim God's forgiveness as a result of our confession. And this is the place where we need to be as specific as we can be, not for God, but for us. And finally, we move from acknowledging our need for God, represented in our deep brokenness, confess our particular sin, and then we can experience forgiveness. And that's really the freedom, friends, that we have been longing for all along. Finally, in this fourth movement of the psalm, in verses 8 through 11, David really challenges us. He invites us to teach others from the wisdom of our own experience. You know, what have we learned through the art and practice of confession and forgiveness that can help others learn from us? You see, it just can't stop with our own souls. As brothers and sisters in Christ, for whatever reason, God invites us to join God in God's work by sharing our own experiences with others so that they too can experience the freedom and the forgiveness that we have found in him. Like I've said before here at Grace, people that have found peace with God through Christ are called in turn to go out and find people and show and share the love of Christ in practical ways. Well, friends, if there's nothing else that this season in the life of the world has given us, it is the gift of time. It's the gift of time. Now, I fully realize that for so many of us, this whole idea of social distancing has been incredibly hard, and it's been incredibly painful. And let me just suggest to you, I think I mentioned this last week, that a better description of what we're practicing is really physical distancing. We don't have to socially distance from each other. I mean, we have more communicative tools at our disposal than we have probably ever had. And so let me encourage you to make use of them. Let me tell you how I, just the last 2 days, made use of them. On Friday night, a group of us pastor families got together from all over the Detroit area. And we joined together on a Zoom call. It's the same app I'm using to do this sermon. And I think there were seven of us, couples in our families. And we did a time of trivia. And it was a blast. It was so much fun. Screen was covered with people that I love. Last night, Melissa Bricker organized with some of the other families in my small group a time to do some trivia together as some members and friends from the church. And we had so much fun laughing. Even the technical glitches that we were dealing with were hilarious. It was so great to see the faces of people I know and love. So yes, you have to be physically distant. We have to be physically distant, but we don't have to be socially distant. Call somebody, use FaceTime, write a letter, write a note. These are all ways. Drop an email. These are all ways that we can get together. But maybe for some of us, what we found during these quiet moments at home, is that while we're forced to be physically or socially distanced from others, we're finding really quickly that we've been spiritually distant from God. And now we're wondering, you know, God, where are you in all of this? Let me just say this as delicately as I can. And this is not trying to guilt anyone. I'm just trying to invite you into a moment. Maybe this would be a good time for you to practice confession, to just tell God, for whatever reason, God, I feel distant from you. I feel like I've sort of disconnected from you over the past days, weeks, months, years. Maybe you just need to practice that confession. I don't mean necessarily the confession of deep and dark sins like King David. If you have those, then by all means, confess those to God. But simply confessing that, well, you know, you and God have grown apart. And that there was a fire that once burned really, really bright. And now maybe the flame's just been flickering for a little while. Maybe for some of us, we could view this time as a strange gift to reconnect with the God whose love for us is boundless and endless and unquenchable. But maybe for others of us, we're really scared right now of what the future holds. I mean, we're really scared. Maybe you're a person of faith and you've been wrestling with your own fears about COVID-19. And maybe you're having this internal conversation with yourself that, you know, if you have a faith in God, you know, if I have faith in God, why are we so scared? Why are we afraid? Doesn't Jesus tell us not to be afraid? Maybe if that's you this week, all you need to do is confess that to God. Just tell him. Friends, there is no sin in being afraid. There is no sin in being afraid, none. But as the Apostle John writes in the first of his three letters, he writes that perfect love casts out all fear. So maybe if we're experiencing a heightened anxiety and fear, maybe it's a sign that we've sort of disconnected ourselves from the source of love. My prayer for you this week is that you would deeply and undeniably experience the love of Christ in such a way that it would bring you peace. That would bring you peace. Well, beloved of the Grace Church community, it's my prayer that we might continue to be a community that practices the art of confession, both to God and to one another, so that we might experience the freedom that comes from our commitment to holiness and wholeness together in our relationships with God and one another. Let's pray. God, in these moments where life seems to be really difficult, in which the future seems at best clouded and at the worst scary, we ask that you would meet us where we are, that you would help us to confess to you those things that we need to confess to you just to get off our hearts so that you can carry the burden. Maybe for some of us this week, Lord, we need to reach out to someone and just have a phone call or a FaceTime or a Facebook video messenger conversation and just share the burden. To listen to each other without judgment so that we can offer words of hope. We thank you that you're present with us and that the confession isn't just good for the soul, but it really has the opportunity to make us whole. And we thank you for your love. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, friends, now's the time, the service. So if we're here live together and we had people and ushers, I'd invite the ushers to come forward for offering. again, this is a unique time in the life of the church. I know that we're not able to gather together as we used to, and you're not able to be here on a Sunday morning, but let me assure you the work of the church is going on really at a feverish pitch throughout the week. Pastor Jeff and myself are coming, trying to learn how to get these things to you in virtual spaces. Our small groups person, Sarah, is learning how to get you content in a virtual space. Our administrative and other ministry staff, Matt, just launched his Grace Kids virtual meeting this morning, just a little while ago. So your kids, if you go over to the Grace Kids Facebook group, and you can check out a full Sunday morning event for your kids. We're doing Chaos, our student ministries, through a virtual Zoom conference. So last week was hilarious. I mean, we must have had like 16, 17 kids on the screen, and everybody's talking at once. It was madness, but it was awesome. So the work of the church is still going on. We still have our food pantry ministry. We're doing a door-to-door service for people in our church who shouldn't be going out and grocery shopping because maybe they're at a higher risk factor for catching COVID-19. So all that to say is the ministry of the church is still going. I mean, we may look like a duck floating peacefully on a lake right now, but let me assure you that under the water, those feet are paddling really, really quick. So we still need your support and encouragement and your gifts and your tithes and your offerings to make ministry happen. There's a variety of ways for us to give here at Grace. You can give through your envelope. You can just mail that into the church office, and we'll make sure that gets counted and attributed to your giving. You can do an EFT, electronic funds transfer. It's not too late to set that up. And that way, no matter where you are in the world, at any given time, your gift will come to the church on a regular basis. You can also go to our website and click on Give in the menu, and you can set up a one-time or a recurring gift. Again, that just helps ministry continue to happen here at Grace. And so I love the fact that Grace is such a generous church and that we are so committed to continue to our vision of loving God, serving all and changing lives, not only here in Bay City, but around the world. So thank you again for your generosity. And I can't wait, friends, I cannot wait to be in this space with you again. I miss all of you. And hopefully some of you miss me, but I miss your hugs. I miss your handshakes. I miss being able to sit in our cafe area and to just inquire as to how you are and what's going on in your lives. Pastor Jeff and I are making our best efforts to make our way through our directory, taking calls to those who are shut in or recently been hospitalized. But we'll get to you. If we haven't called you yet, we're going to get to you because we need to hear your voice and we miss you. So just be patient. We got, you know, between 370 and 400 people to call over the next several weeks. So we're trying to get to all of you. If you need us though, please don't wait for us to reach out to you. Reach out to us. Again, Jeff and I want to be helpful in any way that we can. So friends, receive the benediction. Go now in the grace, peace, mercy, and love of Christ. Knowing that as we confess to him, he is more than ready to forgive. And that God's love for us is deep, and it cannot be quenched. And that God is here within the midst of this pandemic. And that God is holding those who are sick and holding those who are healthy. And that all will be well. Eventually, all will be well. We love you. Have a great week. Again, we'll be back in this space virtually next week. Again, Jeff and I are going to try to do something, some more creative things. So it'll either be live or pre-recorded, but we'll make sure we get these on the pages for you. Have a great week. And, you know, all joking aside, wash your hands, take care of each other. And, we will see you very, very soon. Love you, and, grace and peace to all of you.